Good evening. Welcome. Warm welcome to you all. And welcome to this year's Branigin Lecture of the Indiana University Institute for Advanced Study. My name is Fred Hayman, and I'm the director of the Institute. Our Branigin Lecture is made possible by an endowment from the estate of Mrs. Jean Lois Porteous Branigin, an IU alumna. And since 1999, this endowment has supported a series of lectures, and now this evening, a performance as well, that bring to the Bloomington campus interdisciplinary scholars and artists of great distinction. In addition to lecturing or performing, Branigin scholars and artists meet with a variety of faculty and student groups while on campus, and they share their wisdom and their talent in both formal and informal settings. And it's my great honor and pleasure to introduce the 2004 Branigin lecturer, Fred Hersch. Fred Hersch is one of the most eloquent voices in American music today. He's a composer, a performer, an educator. He writes and he speaks as eloquently as he plays and composes. As a pianist, he's recorded 20 CDs as a leader, 16 CDs as a co-leader, 15 as a featured soloist, and 80 CDs as a sideman. And by the way, many of these CDs are available outside during intermission. Over 50 of his compositions have been recorded at least 11 different labels by scores of different performers. Hersch has performed with the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra, the Utah Symphony, the EOS Orchestra, the Orchestre de Chambre de Lausanne, and numerous other classical ensembles. He composed and or arranged all the music performed with these ensembles. Fred Hersch is also an educator, having taught at the New England Conservatory, the New School University, the Manhattan School of Music, and Western Michigan University. And he has held many residencies. And in 2003, he was awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship in Music Composition. His commitment to social issues is also impressive. He's been an active supporter of classical action, performing arts against AIDS, and his musical contributions to Broadway Cares have provided financial assistance to community groups throughout the country in their fight against AIDS. Fred Hersch has been enormously generous with his time this week, rehearsing for this performance, meeting with many groups of students, administrators, and faculty, taking part in ongoing classes, as well as conducting clinics and master classes. We are deeply grateful and honored that he could be with us and participate so fully, so completely in the life of this university. His composition tonight is set to Walt Whitman's Leaves of Grass. There will be a short intermission during the performance. Parts one and parts two of the performance are continuous, so hold your applause to the very end of each part, if you will. At the end of the performance, we'll take a very short break, and then Fred will return to speak and answer your questions. Please join me in welcoming Fred Hersch.
Due to a miscommunication snafu, you do not have what we would call librettos this evening. And unfortunately, on your program, the particular poems that are comprising the first and second part have not been printed. So I will tell you, in the first part, there'll be four poems. The first is called Riddle Song, and that will be an instrumental piece. There's no text. Second is Song of the Universal. Third is Whoever You Are Holding Me Now in Hand. And then the end of the first part is a rather large chunk of Song of Myself. So as Fred Amon said, please hold your applause to the end. Thank you very much for being here. And it's been a total pleasure getting to know and work with these remarkable young musicians. So here we go.
Thank you. I celebrate myself and sing myself. a child said, "What is the grass fetching it to me with four hands?" How could I answer the child? I do not know what it is any more than he. I guess it must be the flag of my disposition. Out of hope for green stuff woven. Or I guess it is the handkerchief of the as much as mine, they are nothing, or next to nothing. If they are not the riddle and the untying of the riddle, they are nothing. If they are not just as close as they are distant, they are nothing. This is the grass that grows wherever the land is and the water is. This is the common air that bathes the globe. Thank you. through me forbidden voices, voices of senses and lusts, voices veiled and I remove the veil, voices indecent by me clarified and transfigured.
Their meals, the angry bass of disjointed friendship, the faint tones of the sick, the judge with hands tight to the desk, his pallid lips pronouncing a death sentence, the heave-I-O of stevedores, elated ships by the wharves, the refrain of the anchor lifters, the ring of alarm bells, the cry of fire, the whir of swift-seeking engines, and postcards with vibratory tingle and color lights. The steam whistle, the solid roll of the train of approaching cars, the slow march played at the head of the association, marching two and two. They go to guard some corpse, the flag tops are draped with panels. I hear the violoncello. I hear the key cornet. It glides quickly in through my ears. It shakes mad sweet pangs through my belly and breast. A tenor.
And the running blackberries. Thank you. faces of men and women I see.
A child said, "What is the grass?" stretching it to me with full hands. How could I answer the child? I do not know what it is any more than he.
Thank you.
Stranger, if you, passing, meet me and desire to speak to me, why should you not speak to me? And why should I not speak to you? Only themselves understand themselves and the like of themselves, as souls only understand souls.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'll be back out in a few minutes to answer any questions you may have, but I want to thank sincerely Luke Gillespie and the Jazz Department, who did an incredible job organizing all of this for all of us. Is he out there, Luke? Thank you so much. And particular thanks to Ivona Hedden and Fred Amon at the Institute for Band Studies for having me here this week. It's been an amazing week. I've met some wonderful people and hope to have the pleasure of coming back. So we'll just take, just stay where you are, and I'll get a chair and I'll entertain your questions in about 1 minute. Thank you so much. Just gotten word, I think, you know, it's not 100%, but we should, the original ensemble for whom I wrote this piece, we're hoping to record it in August for release in February. And we're going to be taking that ensemble on tour next March. We're playing in Napa County and in San Francisco, in Ann Arbor at the University of Michigan, at Carnegie Hall, at the Zankel Hall, the Kimmel Center in Philadelphia, Lincoln, Nebraska, and I'm not sure where else. So we felt it would be a great opportunity to have the music available on disc. So I'm hoping that it will. It should be next February. So thanks for your interest. Yes.
Were you influenced by Copland?
Was I influenced by Copland? I mean. Sort of Americana.
I hear a lot of major seconds.
Yeah, they do sound nice.
You know.
Yeah, well, it's probably, you know, my background is in classical music and jazz, and also I've been certainly influenced by the music of such composers as Joni Mitchell, you know. Who to me is a, you know, true icon and a real genius. And certainly, you know, it's a, like Whitman's work, which is, you know, Song of Myself is 60 pages and quite sprawling. Basically, I just sort of allowed the music to take me where it wanted me to go. I wrote from the text first, and the compositional process, it actually took me almost 9 months to settle on which poems and parts of poems I was going to use, because Whitman is so vast. And I actually had a little help at the end. I felt like I just needed somebody. I'd looked at these things too many times, and I needed a, you know, some input. So I had some help there, kind of fashioning a libretto that made some sense and made. Certainly the first and second halves of this work are very different in nature. Most of the poems in the first half are early stuff. A lot of the stuff in the second half is later, more reflective. And anyway, it took me about 9 months to sort of get a libretto together. And then I basically composed the music in about a 3-week blitz at the McDowell Colony in a sketch form. And then took another few weeks to sort of orchestrate it. You know, a lot of people have asked, you know, did you choose Whitman because he's a gay poet and you're gay? And I don't think so. I actually ended up not using any of the so-called gay poems of Whitman in this particular. And I didn't use any of the very famous poems either, you know, Crossing Brooklyn Bridge, When Lilacs Last in the Door, and I didn't go there. I couldn't have, you know, Song of Myself I knew had to be part of it. That's too important. But I really just, you know, to me this whole piece, all these words are, it's very universal, ecumenical. It's really about love, and love of nature, and love of other human beings. And, you know, I felt, you know, particularly in these times, you know, the message of Whitman from 150 years ago is incredibly relevant. And I'm sure there's, you know, more poems that I could have set, but this is, you know, and I composed this piece for a unique group of musicians who are great improvisers, not only in the jazz tradition, but in the tradition of what we call open improvisation or open music. And they're also superior instrumentalists, you know, in terms of chamber orchestra. And I picked this particular instrumentation. They're pairs of brass, pair of woodwinds, pair of strings, pair of percussion instruments, me on the drums, and a pair of singers. And it was the largest, I wanted it to sound significant, you know, orchestral in a way, but if it had gotten any larger, it would have needed a conductor, a real conductor. And I think that would not have, I just didn't really want to do that. I wanted everybody to have to listen and contribute and balance themselves. And I think it's just amazing the way these students played this evening. You know, it's really quite remarkable. This is actually the first time that I've performed this piece other than for the people for whom it was written. So it was a great experiment for me, and it's very gratifying to get a chance to present it for you. Any questions? Yes.
It's not really a question as much as it is a comment. It seems the parts of Whitman that you chose are about love, but they're also about presence and being present. To experience it to each other, and the way in which you put the instruments together, requiring that of the musicians as well, and of us in listening to them, is just so eloquent and gorgeous.
Thank you very much. There's that, that's what I call sort of the Buddhist part of Whitman, you know, that, you know, life is the present, and, you know, there's one line towards the end, you know, about, you know, seeing God in the man on the street, you know. It's everywhere, you know, and however you choose to think about spirituality, certainly Whitman was about, you know, celebrating life in the moment, paying attention to the grass and to the insects, and basically saying that, you know, he sees a lot of kind of divinity in nature, you know, and it also ties in with Emerson and Thoreau, certainly. So that's, I kind of went in that direction with it. You know, there's a lot of great poems, and poems about New York, about the Civil War, and so on and so forth. But I did deliberately do that. Let me ask you all a question, if I may. Due to the snafu of not having the libretto, this is the first time I've done it where you all weren't able to actually follow along with the words. Did the words come across out there?
Yes.
Good. Maybe in the future I will actually go that direction, because when people have librettos, they tend to be looking at them and flipping pages and seeing how many more till the end of the first half. You know, and I'd actually thought of an idea originally, was not to give people the librettos when they came in, but make them available as they left.
Yeah.
Do we like that idea?
Yeah.
So you could take it home and sort of look at it, you know, and maybe, I think that's what I'll do henceforth, so I certainly learned something from that tonight. Any other questions or comments?
Yes. Have you any thoughts about composing, the setting for the poems by Whitman?
I'm probably, much as I would probably like to, I've been intrigued by some other writings. Unfortunately, one of my problems is that the literature that I tend to pick tends to be foreign literature and 20th century literature. So that leads to a great number of complications with getting the rights to those pieces. pieces, to those either poems or pieces of literature. You have to deal with the estate of an author and a publisher in a foreign country. And in my case, the two that I'm interested in are Chile and Neruda, and Italy, Calvino. So you have their estates to deal with, their publishers, the American translator, the American publisher. And you know, without a significant commission or funding, it's very hard to get the rights to some of these things. But certainly, this piece clearly is the largest text-related piece I've ever done, and I've really enjoyed working with words. So it's something that I'm certainly, I'm sure pursue. The next kind of composition project that I have is, I have two. One is a piano, violin, cello trio, which I'm going to start next month, which will be premiered in December. And then I'm hoping to compose for my jazz trio. I had an idea of doing a set of 24 tunes or pieces written for them in each of the major and minor keys. You know, so it would be like a full evening, 12 and 12. And I just thought it would be an interesting compositional challenge because being a pianist, you know, I'm very sensitive to temperament and keys. And, you know, there was, it's funny, in this particular piece, there was a lot of D major. That seemed to be the, you know, that seemed to be the dominant. It's not really a, we don't associate it as a kind of jazz key. But it's just sort of where it went. And when I was composing this piece, I was not, I didn't really know where it was going to go. I just had these words, and I thought it actually might have ended up being a little kind of farther left, you know, a little less tuneful, because Whitman, there's never any rhyme or meter. But somehow these kind of tunes came out of it, and it's, I think, ultimately a fairly lyrical piece. It was just, I wasn't expecting it. I didn't know, so I just went with my gut. Yes?
Is there a segment that you prefer, and would you tell us why?
Very good question. I think that I do have favorite parts. The very end, after the dazzled day, that whole kind of, that just kind of seals it. There's some, in the first half in the song of myself, there's a section that goes, I believe a leaf of grass is no less than the journey work of the stars. I'm kind of fond of the sort of Ellingtonia bit, my lovers suffocate me. Spirit that formed this scene, which Nythia, those intimate places. I think there's also a part in The Mystic Trumpeter, where she's singing about, it's a very sort of, it sounds very kind of classical, and I'm quite fond of that section. You know? And this also places a certain requirement not only on the players, but on the vocalists, you know, to make these, there's a lot of words, and I've been working both with Bradley and Nythia this week to give them. You know, it's not about singing it exactly, but you know, I certainly do have some things in mind. So we've spent some time, kind of one-on-one time, loosening up certain places and letting them be more personal in their forms of expression with the words. And that was another thing. I did not want to have just a male singer. I felt it was really important to, because you know, Whitman can be a real guy thing, you know. So, you know, I sort of see the male as sort of universal man and universal woman. And that balances, you know, and some people have commented, gee, you have two great singers, but they only sing together at the beginning and the end. Kurt Elling, who the extraordinary singer who premiered the piece, you know, he actually said, you know, I was thinking about this piece, how to describe it. It's sort of a jazz oratorio, you know, in terms of form, you know, a small scale, and certainly not a religious text, but, and But there's certainly elements of all kinds of things in this. And of course, you know, it's really about the singers, you know, and I wanted to keep the ensemble transparent enough that the singers would not have to struggle. That's also why they're mic'd. I did not want to do this for conventional classical singers, although Bradley and Nythia are, you know, extraordinary classical singers as well. You know, I didn't want them to have to shout. And, you know, so it's definitely a hybrid piece. And, it's very, you know, close to my heart. So. Any other questions, comments, please?
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I really appreciate your attention. It's a great night. Thank you.